So we made it back to the base and completed a little paint makeover on the ugly ship, which now needs a new name. But it also needed a big stress test with more cargo weight and to see if it could satisfy one of its original requirements to carry the large grid rover. But this test led to some good discoveries about gyroscopes, ship balance, and an incredibly important construction piece, the merge block. So test flight 1 to the ENAT station was successful, and the big cargo ship and rover carrier handled well, but it was completely empty of goods and wasn't carrying the rover, so I needed to see if it could really do the job. The test was simple: load the rover and attach it to the two anchor points I had, which was a hinge in the middle and a hinge at the front. Really, I was testing two things. One was to see if the big ship could fly and handle reasonably well with the rover loaded. The other was to see if the rover would even stay attached while in flight. Just a little flight around the open plain, and the rover seemed to be staying intact, and the ship flew fine. So it was time for some aerial maneuvers to see if some stresses and twists would shake off the rover. So, I was happy with that. The flight test was successful, but here's where my issues started. To land the ship back on the pad and reconnect it to the power station, it required some fine maneuvering. The ship was heavy, and I was okay with coming in slow and easing it into position. The real issue was instability. The ship kept wanting to pitch upwards and off to the side a little. To set this ship down in the perfect position to insert it into the hinge, the ship needed to remain stable. I realized a connector would have been more forgiving and given me a little more wiggle room, but this was good. It gave me a chance to test and figure out what was causing the ship's imbalance. Now, the first inclination you might think when you look at the ship is that the lifting thrusters were in the forward part of the ship, and that would naturally cause the ship to be back heavy and make it pitch up. Fortunately, in Space Engineers, that isn't the case. Even though the game does apply a lot of actual physical forces, when it comes to thruster placement relative to the weight distribution of a ship, it doesn't matter. The force of the attached thrusters is applied equally to an entire ship, no matter where they're placed. It may not be entirely realistic, but for game purposes, it allows much greater freedom in ship design. Otherwise, players would probably wind up channeling into a rather standard set of designs that would work. So I needed to find the real source of the problem, and I thought I'd try a simple solution. Maybe the mass of the ship needed another gyroscope. So I tried that, and it didn't work. But I had a new theory, and it was time for a little science to see if I was right. The rover was attached with hinges, which not only added a lot of weight, but put that weight on a separate grid than the rest of the ship. You've heard me talk about connecting together large grid and small grid items with a hinge, and both the ship and rover were large grid, but the connection of the hinge puts both items on separate grids. The thrusters I talked about that distribute the thrust across an entire ship probably wasn't a completely accurate statement I made. It's more like it distributes the thrust across an entire grid. My theory was that the weight of the rover was being added to the ship, but the thrusters and gyroscopes weren't able to compensate for inertial dampening because all that weight was on a separate grid. So it was dragging down the rear of the ship. I was gonna test out the theory a little bit with a very easy little trick. In Space Engineers, you can place a block and it applies the weight of the block even if it's not welded up. So I was gonna take the rover off, apply a bunch of weight to the rear of the ship, and see if it still tipped backwards, purely based on rear weight. I mean, I had applied a lot of weight during the course of the ship's makeover. I had added the refinery and assembler. I'd installed modules on both. I had added a hydrogen and oxygen generator, a large storage container, a hydrogen tank, and had doubled the amount of batteries for longer flight and more power. And just by themselves, the batteries add a lot of weight. So One thing I wanted to eliminate at the same time was the fact that I had added all that weight and could be approaching the limit of my two main thrusters to adequately keep the ship in check. I did only have a minimum complement of small thrusters for other movement also, so maybe it was just getting a little wonky due to the lack of thrust capacity. Probably not, but maybe. The test would test both those things. So with a bunch of test batteries on the back, more than the actual weight of the rover, it was time for a test. And steady as a rock. So my theory was correct, and the total weight was not a factor. The issue was being caused by the rover and its added weight being on a separate grid. But I knew just the fix, a merge block. So there's a few key things you need to know with merge blocks, which keeps them real simple and eliminates some frustration. The first and main thing is that merge blocks merge two grids together to make them operate as if they were a single grid. That was exactly what I needed. If I could get the rover and ship to act like one object on the same grid, then everything should stabilize. But how would I do it, at least without major redesign? My first inclination was to put a couple merge blocks on the ceiling of the bay, and I would kind of slide a couple matching merge blocks on the rover up between them as I lifted the rover on the piston. That, however, was problematic. First problem was that blocks really don't like to slide past each other like that. But the second problem was another thing to know about merge blocks. When you use a merge block to connect two grids and other blocks that are adjacent to each other, ones that would be in the same position as if they were being welded together, they'll do exactly that when the merge blocks merge. They'll weld together. Even if you unmerge the merge blocks, those other welded blocks that form together during the merge will stay welded, and you have to grind at any of those blocks to disconnect them. So positioning those merge blocks on the cargo bay ceiling and letting them connect when I raised the rover wouldn't work. There were several blocks on the rover that basically rested against the bay ceiling when the rover was raised, and they'd weld together during the merge. I did just mention unmerging, which is a third thing you need to know about merge blocks. You can merge and unmerge them at will, but when you unmerge two grids, the name you might have given to one of the two grids will change to one of those very generic names like grid 21947.
We have moved into sector 21947.
When you merge the two grids, they essentially are one grid and adopt one of those two grid names for everything. And right now, it doesn't remember the prior grid's name when you separate them. I think this is fixable by the devs, like storing a grid's name in the merge block's parameters, then ensure that the attribute is reapplied to the grid it's attached to when they separate. But that's not how it works now. It's not a huge problem, but if you've got some scripts running on things that use the grid names, you'll need to remember to keep putting the grid's name back to what it was. I guess the hassle all depends on how often you plan to merge and unmerge the blocks. It took a little head scratching on this one, but in the end, I decided to replace the hinge I had on the front with a merge block, and then just always use the top hinge to transfer resources wherever I needed to use the rover. Whenever I wanted to carry the rover somewhere, which wouldn't be frequent, then I could raise up the suspension a little, drive it straight in, and merge it up. Then, with it solidly merged, I could raise up the suspension even farther to clear the ground for takeoff and landing. The rest of the time, I could just use the hinge for resource transfer. It was kind of perfect. Also, when I test flew this new merged rover and cargo ship setup, it was rock steady. No problems at all. I only had very slight movement from a much lighter scout ship I had on the back, but it was small grid, and the ship was large grid, which led to the fourth thing you need to know about merge blocks. You can only merge grids of the same size. So my small grid scout ship might just have to be what it is for now. I did have a semi-solution, but it wasn't great. and adapting a small grid to a large grid with a hinge or rotor wouldn't work either, because both those items create a separation of grids. And yes, I made a scout ship, or two, and that was a whole adventure into itself, with its own disasters. So like and subscribe to keep watching the story, and I'll be talking to you later.